So this is what a knowledge graph looks like. And in today's talk, we will focus on a few kinds of edge types which indicate belongingness of entities to types. For example, in some knowledge graphs, some entities may be flagged as explicitly being members of or instances of a type. For example, Einstein is a theoretical physicist. And some types will be marked explicitly as subtypes of broader types, like a nuclear physicist is a scientist. But it's not often that knowledge graphs give all type clues in explicit relations. For example, there could be another relation like has profession. So Messi has profession soccer is also a very strong type indicator. In a type system where you have athlete or sports person, Messi having profession soccer playing is enough clue to say what type of a person he is. And the excitement around these sorts of binary relations connecting entities has come about because of continuous embedding of knowledge graphs and words. And if you, many of you will be familiar with word-to-vec or word embeddings that we shall discuss in a moment, where if you take the vector embedding of man and take the vector embedding for king, the difference between these two vectors is about the same as the vector difference between woman and queen. So there's some notion of inherited leadership, which when you bestow on a man becomes a king, and similarly with women. Now, this kind of translation-based representation of relations is of course limited because they cannot address many-to-many relations. If you start from one point and make a fixed translation, you'll always go to another fixed point, you cannot go to multiple points. So that is a different and fascinating field of study, namely the representation of relations and knowledge graphs in a very generic setting in the continuous domain. Today, we will be restricted to talking about the instance of and subtype of relations, where the clues come from other places in the knowledge graph. Why do we want to embed knowledge graphs? Because it can be used then to complete or correct the knowledge graph. Current knowledge graphs are largely sound, but they're very incomplete. Most of the common sense knowledge of the world is not yet in knowledge graphs. Only information about prominent entities are found in knowledge graphs. Lesser people, places, events, they often take a long time to get into the knowledge graph. So to speed up acquisition of structured knowledge, we want to do knowledge graph completion, and continuous representations are a big help in doing that. Another application is question answering. If you know what penicillin is, then if someone asks you who discovered penicillin, you should be able to apply some sort of a discover inverse transformation to a medicine to realize that it could have been discovered by a biochemist or a doctor or a physician, things like that. So there is a certain algebra possible with geometric embedding of types or other KG artifacts that could be useful in question answering. And because the knowledge graph is so incomplete, it often helps to dynamically or offline supplement it with noisy signals from a text corpus. We will not be going into that in today's talk. Now, as I was talking about word-to-vec, in case of word embeddings, each word is given two vector representations, which you could regard as either points in space, or you could regard them as rays from the origin to some point on the unit sphere. So each word has a focus embedding U and a context embedding V. Roughly speaking, this says how the word behaves as a center of a context versus how the word behaves as a context word which predicts the center. So this is a bipartite relationship between the focus and its context word. If word C often occurs in the context of word F, then we want a large inner product between the vector UF and VC. Conversely, if the word C is never or rarely found in the context of word F, we want that dot product to become very small. This is the underlying principle behind most word embedding algorithms like GloVe and Word2Vec. Now, if you had text like Wikipedia, where some spans of text are linked explicitly, to canonical entity IDs. Then you could start regarding these canonical entity IDs as just special words from another vocabulary. For example, in this sentence, young Albert took violin lessons from the age of 3. Albert may be underlined or hyperlinked to a specific definition page on Wikipedia with a certain canonical and standardized URL that never changes. In case of Freebase, that unique ID for Albert Einstein the physicist is m.0jcx. Now, you could think of taking all explicit mentions of Albert Einstein in Wikipedia text and replacing whatever text was used, like Albert or Einstein or Albert Einstein or Professor Einstein, and replacing it with the string m.0jcx, making sure it doesn't appear elsewhere in the corpus as an ordinary word. At this point, if you run glove or word2vec on this corpus, you are going to get embeddings for entity IDs, just like you get embeddings for ordinary words. The difference is that two entities may both be called Albert, like Albert Einstein and Prince Albert of England, but they are now going to get vastly different embeddings. Albert Einstein's ID, m.0jcx, is going to get a U vector, which will be close to the U vector of the word relativity. And that makes sense. So this is how word embeddings work, and entity embeddings can be extended to behave just like word embeddings and be in a consistent space. So the next natural question is, if words and entities are like points or single vectors, then what are types? Now, you could always say, let types also be points. For example, if we collect 5,000 instances of the class nuclear physicist, and we compute the entity embeddings of all of those 5,000 nuclear physicists and then average them, for example, that could give you some sort of a representation of the type nuclear physicist. But as we know, in 300 dimensions, the average may not be that meaningful. Perhaps what we are looking at is more like a region in entity space that represents a type. The other limitation of regarding type as a point is that it's hard to do calculations between two types that can represent antisymmetry or transitivity. What do you do with two points anyway? You can at best measure distance. So standard symmetric geometry is not very suitable for characterizing the representation of types. This was appreciated many years ago. Vilnius in 2014 realized that the KL divergence is asymmetric, and this can be harnessed to represent asymmetric relations between two types. Type 1 may be a subtype of type 2 without type T2 being the subtype of type 1. So, but this leads to certain other inconsistencies and conceptual issues. If you look at this picture on the right, imagine that these ellipses represent like a 1 sigma ellipsoid around multivariate Gaussian clouds. Now, it looks like the artist's blob is somehow narrower and contained in the people blob because the artist's blob has a smaller magnitude covariance matrix. But if you look at the picture sideways, so to speak, then to keep the total mass under the densities normalized to 1, the artist this density has a much sharper peak. So what is inside and what is outside becomes a little confused here. The other question is, are we positing type representations as Gaussians because we are uncertain where it should be? Or are we doing it because it tries to model a whole bunch of points which were generated from an unknown distribution? So these are some of the issues. And in any case, transitivity is not so directly enforced. And asymmetry doesn't, for example, mean antisymmetry. You cannot, for example, say that if A is a proper subtype of B, then B cannot be a proper subtype of A. So the Gaussian representation is a little unsatisfactory, and as we shall see in examples, it doesn't do that well either. Another interesting proposal made in 2016 is to represent a type in d-dimensional space using d plus 1 points, t0 through td. Now, this means that in principle, these d plus 1 points can span the entire d-dimensional space. To try to make the type representation a strict subspace of the whole d-dimensional space, you take an arbitrary vector out of them, say t0, and then connect it to all the other d vectors, t1 through td, and then look at the difference vector. So t1 minus t0, t2 minus t0 through td minus t0. If you take this d by d matrix and its rank is incomplete, then you know that all these d plus 1 points must be lying on a lower dimensional manifold. And one way to try to enforce this is to minimize some optimizable surrogate of the rank of this matrix, one of which surrogate could be the nuclear norm. At the same time, we want all the member entities of a type to be close to the type hyperplane. And the way to do that is to say, is to minimize over all entities type vectors, then the sum over all types, sum over all entities belonging to the type, the minimum distance from E to some linear combination of the representational type vectors. So this means find some combination, convex combination, because the lambda 0 through lambda d is part of the d plus 1 simplex, so that E is closest to that point composed of the d plus 1 type exemplars. Now this has certain degeneracies. Unless you succeed in squashing down the rank of the type difference matrix to exactly less than the full d, the type is still going to span the whole space. It might be a very thin slab, but you can always find these lambdas to bring the sum over lambda t to be very close to E. So there are certain degeneracies in the system which you observed fairly often in practice. The other problem is that you cannot enforce transitivity by construction. What this does give you, though, is interesting possibilities of intersections of types. So you could say politician is a hyperplane, and actor is a hyperplane, and Arnold Schwarzenegger is at the intersection of the politician hyperplane and the actor hyperplane. So that's an interesting prospect. In 2015, people sort of left behind the more esoteric Gaussian and subspace embedding ideas and said, let's do something very elementary, which is, if X is less preferred than Y, for example, X is an element of Y or X is a subset of subtype of Y, then we want to represent X and Y with vectors U such that UX has to dominate UY element-wise. So to give you a little picture, people is a very general type, and so anything inside the blue cone, half open cone, the infinite space, dominates that apex or the vertex of people. So any point belonging in the blue space is an instance of people or a subtype of people. Now actor is a subtype of people, and therefore actor is this sub cone, right? And politician is this other sub cone, and of course they are subtypes or subset regions of the people region. Schwarzenegger lies in the intersection of actors and politicians. Now, how do you optimize for it? If I give the system a bunch of examples, some positive examples, some negative examples. In some cases, I say X is a subtype or element of Y. In some other cases, we say it's not. Somehow, we organize negative samples. I would like to optimize a loss function which looks like this. So, let L be a squared hinge loss. This is what they propose. It's not our proposal. A squared hinge loss, which goes positive if X does not dominate Y. Okay, if X dominates Y element-wise, then L is 0. So the loss for the positive pairs is very simple. It's just the sum over pairs XY, LXY. We want that to be small. Now, if I give you a negative instance where X is not a subset or a instance of Y, then you would like L to be large. And the way they implemented that is they wanted L to become large and beat a margin alpha and then impose a hinge loss on that. So for the negative instances, you want LXY to be large. Now there's a bunch of problems in this design. First of all, the squared hinge loss is susceptible to outliers, but you could replace it by a linear hinge loss. No big problem there. The bigger issue is that The same L function, small l, has been used for both L plus and L minus, and that's somehow wrong. That's a wrong intuition, because for dominance to work, dominance has to hold in all dimensions. Whereas, if you want violation of dominance, only violation in one dimension suffices. So, there is a marked asymmetry in L plus and L minus, which Vendrav et al. Never built into their loss functions. And this makes for a huge difference in performance. This we really regard as insufficient modeling or a mistake. So, here is the first fix that we did, and that is to introduce this asymmetry of max versus min. If x and y is a positive example and you want x to be less preferred than y, then for all dimensions we want uxd to be larger than or equal to uyd. So we take the max as the violation. Whereas if x is not a subset of y, then for some dimension we want uxd to be less than or equal to uyd. So ux and uy have flipped positions and we take a min after applying a hinge insight. So, in the interest of saving time, I have to kind of rush through it, but if you do some scribbling on a piece of paper, you will see that this exactly captures this notion of dominance in all dimensions to satisfy and violation of dominance in at least one dimension to not satisfy. And just so that one instance cannot start hijacking the entire objective because the hinge loss grows linearly with the violation, we can apply some sort of a stiffness parameter to it, give it a little margin, then apply a sigmoid to make it a more normalized per instance vote of whether the containment constant has been met or not. Now, of course, applying all these functions on a hinge and that too with a max and min variously inside is horribly non-convex, but we don't panic anymore on seeing non-convex optimizations. But this still has a problem. So this is the first problem, that this business of violation was inherently asymmetric and not captured. But the second problem is that half open conical spaces can never model negative correlation. They always intersect somewhere or the other, as you saw in the previous chart. And in fact, they all have the same infinite measure. In fact, the size of all intersections has the same measure as the size of each type. In a finite knowledge graph and a finite world, we don't expect infinite cones. In fact, the points populating them are all restricted to maybe very small distance from the origin. So, we cannot, for example, say that X is a furniture means X cannot be a scientist, hopefully. So the standard fix is, if one cone doesn't do it, apply a cone from the other direction. The intersection of two cones is a rectangle. Two axis aligned rectangular cones, right? So let a type be basically a range in each dimension. Subtypes and instances should be contained. For example, Einstein should be contained in physicist, should be contained in scientist. Einstein is a point, physicist is a small rectangle, scientist is a larger rectangle. All in d-dimensional space, where d could be 50, 100, etc. And not subtypes and not instances should not be contained. So couch and furniture should become disjoint. And this is the sharp difference between the earlier formulation and this formulation. Mathematically, it doesn't cost you much. It's basically just another set of cones. But you have to just design and tweak the loss function a little bit to do the right thing. In other words, all we are doing here is learning to lay out rectangular Venn diagrams properly, given a few examples. So, to cut the details and all the symbols, it's not really necessary. The whole idea is, if x is contained in y, then for all dimensions, the interval of x must be contained in the interval of y, as shown in the picture above. And if there has to be a violation, then the red interval has to stick out of the green interval one way or the other. And these two equations with maxes and mins and a bunch of hinge losses basically implement this intuition. There is, of course, the question of how to combine across dimensions, and that's an interesting point. I won't have time to discuss all those fine points in a short talk, but those are important. And also, we have to regularize the volume of the rectangles so that the rectangles do not balloon arbitrarily to capture, elements, entities of the same type, which have somehow wrongly been scattered all over space. So the rectangles have to try to tighten to collect together the entities belonging to it. Rectangles have to still fit inside their super type rectangles, and these are the forces which will help us train the boundaries of the rectangle by gradient descent. The third problem with earlier work, and in fact continuing work, is that the evaluation protocol used to assess the quality of these type embeddings has a lot to desire for. So this is what Vendroff did. Suppose you start with an available partial order. See, the difficulty in this problem is that sampling, learning, and train, dev, and test folds is tricky because they're all coming from the same graph. And in fact, asking test questions about entities and types that you have never seen in the training fold is meaningless because I don't have embeddings for them. So on one hand, your training and test folds have to share entity and type IDs. On the other hand, you cannot leak all kinds of crazy information that comes because the same graph is holding all these nodes. So continuing, they start with this available partial order and then calculate its transitive closure. WordNet has 82,000 synsets or noun representations as nodes, and they are connected by hypernemy edges. Like I was saying, Einstein is a physicist, is a scientist, etc. If you compute the closure of those 82,000 types and their edges, you get 838,000 edges in the closure. From this, they sampled a positive eval or test fold, E plus, of 4,000 edges, and another different 4,000 edges for the development fold. And then they revealed all the other 830,000 edges as training data to the algorithm. Now this should set alarm bells ringing in your mind, because with 830,000 edges out of 838,000 edges known, what is left to discover? So a key question is, if we just take the training fold L plus and without regard to anything else, no learning algorithm, just compute the closure of L plus, what fraction of E plus or D plus can we cover? And the answer is a huge fraction. So just computing transitive closure on L plus gave zero on accuracy of 88.6%. And in fact, Gaussian embedding is worse than just computing transitive closure at 86.6%. And order embeddings, as presented by Vendroff, got a slim improvement beyond just transitive closure at 90.6%. In fact, order embedding was undersold in their paper. If you reduce the amount of training data, then the gap between transitive closure and order embeddings actually grows. But still, we are now, in this evaluation scheme, we are rewarding any algorithm for computing transitive closure as well as learning a nice topological arrangement of the boxes or rectangles given partial samples of edges from the directed acyclic graph. So can we fix this protocol? Now, we went to the other extreme. One might argue that sometimes it's important to calculate transitive closure, but we don't really need deep learning algorithms for doing that. We know how to calculate transitive closure much easier. So we are going to give no credit for computing transitive closure. We are first going to sample the training fold as a subset of different sizes from the closure of T, and then we are going to compute negative samples by perturbation, as is very common, and discard the negative sample if it's actually positive, and so on. But the most important line is the second last line, which is that the positive evaluation fold or the test fold is sampled from the closure of T minus the closure of L plus and the closure of D plus, the training fold and the dev fold. This means that inferring something by just running transitive closure on the training and dev fold is not going to give me anything. And then we perturb and discard as before. Now, the sanitized protocol results in a huge drop in accuracy. And this is kind of expected because transitive closure is not helping you at all. From accuracies like 0.922 of the ordered embedding algorithm and F1 score of 0.916, the sanitized protocol drops it to 0.57, which is almost like random guessing, and an F1 score of 0.262. So this is really terrible. On the other hand, our slightly improved order embedding, which is still not boxes or rectangles, that maintains some respectable values of accuracy and F1 score. Whereas the rectangle, as expected, because it can capture negative correlations and repulsions between rectangles in some sense, that gives the highest and best performance. So rectangle is better than improved OE, which is much better than original order embeddings. And in fact, rectangle also is the best under the leaky protocol. So we have not really lost anything, but we have shown that rectangle can stand up to a much stronger scrutiny of what evaluation means in the setting of sampling edges from partial orders. So this is sort of the first half of the talk, where we were supervising types by name. So artists are a rectangle, sports people are a rectangle, and we're giving them names, we're giving relationships between them, and seeing how the algorithm can lay them out in multidimensional rectangular space. Any questions about this part before I move on? So supervising types by name, so this there is a recall position plot. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, go on.
So this is shows about the same information. It just tells you that our prediction scheme can be turned into a scoring scheme as well, based on how much of the hinge loss is violated. And then this can be used for ranking and area under the curve and mean average precision and so on. And as you can see from the plots, rectangles have a higher precision at lower recall than order embedding. But symbolic supervision of types tends to be tedious and tricky. So entities which build and maintain knowledge graphs have all suffered from it in the past. You might say all actors are people in a moment of carelessness, but that would make Lassie and Flipper and Air Bud all people, right? And these are breeds of dogs, and therefore all their instances would become people as well. I mean, these instances are people, therefore their super instances have also to be contained in people. So all golden retrievers are people. I mean, I'm sure some people agree strongly to that, but knowledge graph designers might get a little upset. So, but after all, you know, why do we name types by symbols anyway? As I was saying in the beginning of the talk, if you ask people who discovered penicillin, symbolically people may be a little hesitant to choose between doctor and chemist and biochemist. But if you think of entities in some sort of an embedding space, you roughly know where the discoverer of penicillin has to be embedded. So perhaps we should avoid giving names to types as long as we can, and regard types as just a noisy shorthand for attributes that an entity can have and relations in which the entity can participate. Epistemologically, that's all that there is to a type. So long back, you know, several years before the advent of deep learning models for relation inference, Sebastian Riedel and others presented a model called the E model, which did some kind of argument type checking for a relationship. They actually intended it to be a relation predictor, but in effect, all they're doing is checking the types of the endpoints for compatibility with the relation. Every entity was embedded to a vector A, and every relation was in fact embedded to two vectors, VR and WR. These are type checking vectors. And the fact score of a subject relation and object was given as just AS.VR, the subject's embedding types times the or dot product with the relation's subject type checker plus AO dot product with WR. And if that was large, they said the relation works and the relation holds. If this was small, they said the relation cannot hold. Now, this is a little one-sided in the sense that type incompatibility certainly disqualifies a relation SRO from holding, but type compatibility does not ensure that the relationship holds. So naturally, this was not one of the most well-performing models for relation prediction, and the work on relation prediction has gone far ahead with very sophisticated models beyond this sort of simplistic type checking. However, we found this valuable to add on to a more state-of-the-art relation predictor to get better numbers. So what are these state-of-the-art relation predictors? Things have changed a little bit in the last 1 year or so, but the disk malt and complex models are still among the best for predicting edges in the knowledge graph. So how does disk malt work? Every entity is embedded to a vector A sub-entity, like A sub-subject or A sub-object, and the relation itself is also another vector. And the score of the relationship holding, SRO holding, is just some sort of a three-way inner product between A, B, and A, as you can see. Now, it's also clear that this can only model symmetric relations. So if SRO holds with a strongly large score, then so does ORS, which may not be true in practice. So this is a limited model in that sense, and this was fixed by the complex model, where again, S, R, and O were embedded to vectors, but this time complex vectors. And as you can see in the three-way dot product, the AO vector is conjugated. So you take the complex conjugate of the AO vector, and this leads to this valuable asymmetry. In fact, it can automatically fit antisymmetric relations as well. So there's a nice three-line proof of that fact. So complex and disk malt are pretty good. Complex is better for asymmetric and antisymmetric relations. However, they do fail. And when they fail, crazy things happen. As you can see in this table, if you give subject S, Howard Leslie Shore, and the relation is follows religion, and the gold object is Jewism, the predictions from one or both of these models is a movie and another movie, right? And then Les Fradkin was born in location New York, but the prediction are people. So somehow, although they are doing a lot in terms of modeling the geometry of the knowledge graph, when they get it wrong, they are violating basic type consistencies that humans would never get wrong. So how can we fix it? And more important, how can we fix it if we do not want to hand supervise the type of every entity? After all, the types of many, many entities in large knowledge graphs are incomplete, and that's why you do knowledge graph completion in the first place. So depending on a really reliable attachment of all types of an entity is excessive dependence. So we wanted to get an unsupervised way to train additional type checkers with the disk malt and complex framework so that the type checkers and the type embeddings of each entity would train together. And this is how the architecture panned out. Now, a relation will have two type parts. This is like in the E model, and one residual part B, which is the part that we will use for disk malt or complex. So it has a subject type checker VR, a disk malt or complex part BR, and an object type checker WR. And an entity embedding will also now have a type part UE and a residual part AE. So the subject has US and AS, the object has UO and AO. The expectation is that the type part of the vector can be narrower because a lot of entities share those characteristics. And what is exceptional about this entity over and beyond its type is packed into the A vector. And although we didn't do it with much enthusiasm, you could force the A part to be sparse or have small norm and so on. So at this point, we have the subject and the object lined up like this. And now, the disk malt objective would be computed directly from the two A's and the B as before. However, the new stuff that happens is that a subject type checker would take V and U and emit some kind of a score of compatibility between the subject of this relation R and what is being offered as the subject. Similarly, the object type checker checks for compatibility between W and WR and UO. And now all these three scores are put together to emit the eventual output score. And these three parts have to be locally normalized to 0, 1. It's very important that an excellent DM score or relation prediction does not overwhelm an incompatibility in the type of the subject or the object. So they have to all be cut to size before combining them. So that's the overall framework. The combination function, of course, is something that you have to depend on some creativity and data analysis to design. and eventually we train the parameters inside these boxes using various loss functions and training protocols. You can see the paper for details about what works best. I'm not going to discuss some of the fine points in the design of these objectives. But to cut to the chase, the most important statement is that each of the typed variants uniformly improves by a fairly huge margin the performance of the base model. So type DM is better than DM, type CX is better than CX. So, and of course, you know, DM and CX themselves are much better than the E model, which is no surprise. But the nice thing is that by combining and co-training parts of this EM model with parts of the DM and CX model, we can improve all of them. So broadly, you know, and type DM is better than DM, type CX is better than CX, and at that point, type CX was the state of the art. Since then, totally different techniques in the direction of tensor factorization have beaten these numbers. But the real question we wanted to ask, beyond like, you know, doing leaderboards and beating other people's numbers, is, are the type variants really learning to abstract the type info in that those U vectors? While training these, we did not tell the algorithm that certain edges are better clues or indicators of type belongingness than others. We just gave the knowledge graph as and, you know, how available. So we didn't mark certain edge types as type revealing edges. In spite of that, can we show that the U vectors that are being learned are somehow strongly correlated with secretly known type revealing KG edges? I hope that statement is clear, right? So the KG comes with edges which are not type revealing and edges which are type revealing. We've mishmashed all of them into the same knowledge graph and presented it to the algorithm. The algorithm had to figure out the U vectors of the entities. And now we are interested in knowing if those U vectors have secretly learned to extract information from edges that we know are type revealing, but we didn't reveal to the algorithm. So how did we do that? We looked at entities which were members of person, location, organization, films, and sports. In fact, this covers 85% of the entities in the very well-known FB15K dataset. This is not 15,000 entities, this is 15,000 edge types, I think. And then, after embedding is over, we took various vectors, like the U vector or the A vector, and we did two-dimensional PCI projections. As you can see, and then we didn't reveal these types while training type DM or type CX. So the first chart at the bottom right shows what happens if we do a 2D PCA of the AE vectors of these five colored types. And sure, they are clustered, so the entities, even the residual vectors, are showing clustering, but there's also a lot of mixing going on around the boundaries. The red and the green are very well mixed, and yellow is running into black, and so on and so forth. And remember, this is a 2D projection. So on the other hand, if we took type DM and we took its A vector, things have actually gotten a little worse, definitely not any better. So black has kind of separated out, it's still overlapping a lot with yellow. Yellow and red are probably running together and so on. So somehow the A vectors are never that great at separating even these five very broad categories of different types of things. What happens if you use another vector? For example, if you use the U vector? So now you see how well separated they are. Things have become much sharper. The black clusters are hardly ever running into blue clusters now. The green clusters are very well separated from all the other colors. Right? So the separation is a much more, and this is not only visually. We actually evaluated multidimensional notions of separation, and they confirm our visual intuition that in fact taking the U vector leads to much better separation of these types. And if we took the complex embeddings U vector as well after suitable projection, we found similar patterns. Green and blue are very well separated. So the separation coefficient is also better numerically. You can also ask, rather than have this kind of visual clustering and look for separation between the colors, do the U vectors as input into some sort of a type classifier predict one of these five types much more accurately? So it's a turning it into a supervised problem. And sure enough, that also holds. So you can skip most of the numbers in this chart, but look at the deep green ones. For both type DM and type CX, if we take the U vectors, which are only 19 dimensional, by the way, the reason why we chose this funny number of dimensions is because we had to do a fair comparison and roughly balance the number of real number parameters used by the computing models in this table. So we found a good balance point with 19 dimensions in U and 180 dimensions in A. Whereas the original models were using 200 dimensions overall. So that kind of balanced us out. So as you can see, with only 19 dimensions of the type part, U, we can actually get a better prediction accuracy for these types than you can with 200 dimensions taken out of A. So this clearly shows that some type information is being captured and pulled into the U vectors, although we never made any explicit attempt to do that or even to decorrelate the information in the A and the U. So that's sort of the punchline in that, you know, clearly we are separating type information automatically without supervision. So the summary is that compared to words, entities and relations, type representations have not been studied that much in the literature. In addition, at least we have here embedded entities as single points, just like words. Even that can be improved. A multifaceted entity like Barack Obama can be, in a certain context, a parent, a husband, and in other contexts, be a leader, a book writer, a lecturer. Right? So that's very different from the phenomena of ambiguity. When a word is ambiguous, it's not like the word can simultaneously hold these meanings. It's just that the river bank and the financial bank had two different names to start with, and then by force, their name were collapsed in one. That's a little different from saying Obama has all of those attributes. It's just that different attributes surface in different circumstances. So this hasn't been modeled yet, and we are doing some work on that. And as I said, this kind of work is strongly motivated by knowledge-based completion, fine type annotation, and question answering. And we have presented two vignettes of what happens if you attack the problem in the supervised setting and the unsupervised setting. And some obvious questions are, can you add corpus context to the rectangle models? Or, in the first part of my talk, types were rectangles. In the second part, types were still points, although they were carefully built and separated from the other part of the entities. So can we make anything improve if we chose rectangular embeddings even in the second part, in a non-supervised setting? So that's the end of my talk, and I'm happy to take questions.
So we have time for a few quick questions. So, have a question?
Hi, it's Wendy. Can you pull out the people aspects? Where are we going to apply this work? I shouldn't use the word apply. How will people use it? It's great work. How are we going to use it?
Right. So that's a longish story, but let me try to sketch one.
Okay.
So once we have either point or rectangular representations of types, we can use them in other neural networks to label token spans as instances of some types. For example, there may be a relatively obscure county cricket player called John Smith, and a passage says that John Smith hit four sixers in an over playing against Manchester last week. And this particular John Smith is not so famous as to be in Wikipedia or Freebase. But we would like to identify this John Smith as a surefire match with a cricket player. And later on, if you're asking a query saying which cricketers have scored at least four over boundaries or sixers in an over, I should be able to pull up the snippet properly. So identifying fine types in running text is one key reason why we would like to embed types. Also, if the knowledge graph is incomplete and I somehow knew that Obama belonged to these 10 categories, but a person who is not that well known has missed some of the types that should be connected to him, then we can also do that. And that would help in question answering as well. Does that give you some partial answer?
Yes, great answer, but you gave it like a computer scientist.
Oh, I...
it's all right. I don't play football or cricket either, but otherwise, great answer.
Hi, this is Srinath here from IIIT Bangalore. So I was wondering if you distinguish between types and roles, because suppose you say Obama is a president or an author and so on, it's more of a role rather than a type, right? Where type is more context-free, when roles are more context-specific. And secondly, secondly also that types also embed not just attributes but constraints, which are inherited by the instances or subtypes. Do those also remain when you embed them in using the different thing?
So I think rectangles is probably a way too crude to expect constraints to be preserved. But let me give you pointers to two papers which start talking about this. So this matter of role versus context dependent or context specific role versus context independent types, right? So there's a nice paper by Hinrich Schudza and a student, Yadola Yaqubzadeh, 2 years back or 3 years back, where they are saying that what is known to the knowledge graph is in some sense a noise resilient aggregation or unification of what you learn from specific contexts. So loosely speaking, Obama is a lawyer if there is a sufficient amount of evidence that he is a lawyer. And the types to which an entity are connected in the knowledge graph are sort of a union over all contexts. Right? Now, in reality, any specific extraction from a specific context can be a victim of noise. But you expect that if you do averaging or pooling over a sufficient number of contexts, the global estimate of the knowledge graph is not too bad. And then they said, suppose you had this global signal to start with, would you like to revise how you would like to deal with each context so that you make a better estimate of the role in the local context? So it was a case of multiple instance, multiple label learning, MIML learning. And they gave a simple neural formulation for it, which was shown to be more effective than looking at every context in isolation. So that's one nice paper that I would encourage you to read. The second one was about constraints, and that takes us into a slightly hairy territory in the sense that there are all these correspondences between logic and tensor calculus that you can represent fairly interesting classes of logic using just, you know, computing with tensors, algebraic functions. And people have started learning those things. So Chris Manning had a student who did some work on that. Can logic be represented in tensor and matrix arithmetic? So, but the geometry of those is of course much more complicated than just rectangles or dot products. Do we want to throw arbitrarily complicated networks at these things? I'm not too sure. One of the advantages of the kind of network I showed in the second part of my talk is that you can easily debug these things. You can say, okay, if this relation is not certified, that's because subject-to-object compatibility is low versus the subject's type is wrong, and so on. And so we really use this interpretability to debug our system and improve it. We could always throw S, R, and O into some immensely complicated network which we can't understand.
Hi, this is Roshir Contractor from Northwestern. So I mean, I like your talk very much, and I wanted to just check an assumption that I think was being made, but I'm not sure, and I'd love to get some feedback on it. Is the work that you're talking about assuming that there is a ground truth? Like, we're talking about factual things, like there's a cricketer, you know, an actor, etc. Earlier this morning, for example, before lunch, we heard a talk by Karthik Sankaranarayanan, who was talking about the IBM, you know, the project of the debate, where it's not a ground truth necessarily that you can disambiguate to, but you're having different opinions and you want to be able to capture that. So how first of all, is it in fact ground truth that most of what you're dealing with, and how would you deal with situations in the knowledge graph where there isn't a disambiguated
right. So I think so. In a different project we are doing in IIT Bombay, we have been looking at biases and fakeness of news by aggregating over their past behavior and so on. And that's, of course, a very important area of work. And in case of debating, you might even deny the possibility that there is an objective truth. It's just a matter of having a fun debate, right? So in technically, in our case, we believe that there exists a ground truth, but its representation in the knowledge graph may be imperfect. So as I said in my first couple of slides, we expect the knowledge graph to be largely sound, but we very much expect it to be incomplete. So that's why we can sample a bunch of edges from the partial order and then expect the algorithm to embed the nodes in a way that other edges can be either proven or guessed or even refuted, saying, no, this is a very low probability edge.
One last one.
Sir, I'm Skanda of KVIT. So I wanted to ask that. I'm still learning Python, but I wanted to ask you, there is some, you told about neural network, right? So my doubt is, now, if the person writes something, and the machine sees and tell, can it tell that this person is around this to this age, or can give any data by just seeing the handwriting?
Oh, handwriting. Oh, sure. You know, there are all sorts of things that, in fact, your mobile phone routinely does to get a fairly good lock on, you know, how old you are, what kind of music you like, that sort of thing. So, yeah, you speak, one can profile you. You type, one can profile you. So, sure. There's plenty of information out there on how to do that. If you type 2,000 words to your friends over Facebook or some other social media, it's fairly easy to know your political inclinations. So yeah, the answer is yes. There are plenty of techniques to do these things.
Thanks,
Aman,
again.
Thank you very much. Bye.